staying and still being awake. No, not too happy after dinner, but, as I can see. So my name is Bert, I'm a software craftsman at JPoint, and I am currently working for our clients, a non-purpose educational publisher. I'm also a user group leader for AmsterdamJUG, the Java user group in the Netherlands. And my job for the first part of this presentation is to keep my mic shut, so go through this and give Tim.
Right. Thank you, Bert-Jan. I'm Tim van Eijndhoven. I'm also a software craftsman at JPoint. I also work for Malmberg, our client, and I write some articles for the Dutch Java magazine of the NLJAR. Malmberg is basically where all this starts. So today I want to talk to you about, I will talk to you about the performance testing process. So we started this whole thing with Gatling because we have a certain philosophy about how performance testing should be embedded in the development process. Talk about that, and then we go to the more hands-on part in which Bert-Jan will show you Gatling and with some cool demos. So how it all started? As I told you, it started at Malmberg. From management and business, there was a driver to have our development teams mature even more. We already have a pretty advanced development process, and so we're constantly looking to mature. And one of the areas in which we thought we could mature was in the performance testing area. So there was a big plan to hire some performance testing consultants from the testing firm that we use at Walmart to educate all of our developers in performance testing. But that would require actually hiring these people, and they're quite expensive. So Bert-Jan and I were sitting in a small area, a small room, talking about this and how should we tackle this problem. And then, well, we said, why don't we do it ourselves? I mean, we've all seen performance testers do their job. Our philosophy is it should be part of the development process. So we think developers should do it. So why not try and look for the solution ourselves? So that's where we started. And eventually ended up with Gatling. So the core part of our philosophy is that performance testing should be part of the process, of the development process. And it should be a prime part of the development process, not some afterthought. So if you look at performance testing traditionally, it happens, well, several times per year or often less, right, depending on which environment you work in. It traditionally is done only at major releases, and it's performed by specialists, by performance testing specialists often. But that's not ideal. So what you get when you only do this several times a year is that the changes in the code that were made that actually led to the performance degradation or improvement are actually made a long time ago. So when you do some performance testing and you find a problem, then you have to look through all these changes that were made in between to actually find the root cause of your performance problem. There are many changes. The longer the time, there are probably more changes. It's only at a certain moment in time. So when you do a performance test and you get a figure like, well, I can do, or the average response time of my request is like 100 milliseconds or whatever, then you have to realize that average response time is only is only valid at the moment of your measurement. As soon as the first extra code change is pushed, that 100 milliseconds, well, it might still be the case, but you can't be sure about it. When we talk about performance testing tradition, is you done at major releases. So when do you determine when a performance test is actually required? So let's do a show of hands. Who of you have testing in their definition of dot? Or wait, let me first start. Who of you are working in a traditional waterfall environment?
Hopefully nobody.
Right? Okay. So who are you working in actually an agile process, a scrum process? Okay, right. So who of you have a definition of done in that process? In a definition of done, is automatic testing of changes a part? Right. And is the performance testing of code part of your definition of done? All right, well, excellent. Yeah, some hands. Yeah, very good. So traditionally, we see that this is more of the waterfall way. So you have a design, a functional design, a technical design, and you write some code, you test your code. So we're all developers. We most of us are probably developers here with the Java. Which, by the way, I have a confession to make. The previous speaker told that he had a certification for Java 1.2. I don't have any certification at all. So we write code, we test code, and as a developers, we are now mature enough to actually write the automatic unit test, integration test, because it improves our code. It's no longer a boring thing to do, but we actually see the added value. So after we run this test, we write more code, and bit of a circle. And then at some point in time we say, well, now this is ready for production. Now let's do the performance test. And after the performance test succeeds, we do a release. So this is traditional waterfall model. Now when we do continuous delivery, we have the whole circle with the short iteration, right? So we do the same functional technical design, we write code, we test code, and we release. And we do this at a very fast pace. We have development cycles of 2 weeks, so every 2 weeks we bring a new release live. There are companies, booking.com, I expect Walt.com as well, but it's only an assumption, does it even more frequent than that. So where does the performance testing have its place in this circle? Well, we think it's actually part of the testing of code. It's no longer a separate step, right? It's just part of the regular testing cycle of your code. So we think this is a necessity because a continuous delivery, right, in this agile process and this frequent releases to production actually demand the code to always be production ready. There have to be short feedback cycles. You make a change, you want the direct feedback of test results, of changes you make to the code. And we think that the continuous delivery actually demands the code to be maintained by self-supporting teams. So you have a team which build a product, and this team should be self-supporting. It should be it shouldn't be dependent on external experts. That's our philosophy. So when you put these fundamentals and then put this in perspective performance, then you have to see that if code has always been production ready, it should also be that the performance of this code should be under control, right? We should know at any given point of time that the code that we want to put to production is actually up to the task, right? So that our change does not have hasn't brought a regression which will actually cause our product to fail when it's in production at large scale. The short feedback cycles, right? So not only the regular unit tests or integration test results should be visible soon, but also the effects on performance should be visible right away. And the self-supporting part actually means that we do not want to have to hire external specialists. Of course, we still see added value, right, for performance testing expert, because when you try to performance test your application, it's a certain skill to do this right. so we as a as developers can do quite a lot in this area, but still, when you want to actually measure how much users your product can endure in a real production situation, well, then there the skill set of performance testing engineers actually helps you to define the right flows through the application to determine this this number. So it should be part of the process, and it should have the same level of support as our unit test and integration tests. It should be part of the continuous integration. Zero time on deployments that we do with continuous delivery. All of these are already part of the process that we have, because we have seen that that this is important. We saw that years ago, and now we're all doing this. And it should be performed by the development team, as I told you. So when we look at the process of performance testing, it's quite basic. So we have a designing of our scenarios, we have the recording of the scenarios, then we have these recordings, right? So we actually still do the manual recording of a click through the application. This recording we have to what we call operationalize. So when you click through an application, you have one scenario, and then you often have some variables, right, which you output from one request has to be input from the next request and all that sort of stuff. So we have to actually change the scripts in a way to support this. And then we have to execute such a script and report it. It's a really basic process. And for us as a developer, I mean, designing and recording and operationalizing, that's something that we can do, as well as an external tester with expensive tools. So just one slide to give me to actually move slightly into the territory of the testers. So you have two basic performance testing types of scenarios. You have the generic tests that are to test your core functionality. These are the tests that we run continuously, which actually show if there is any performance degradation in the basic functioning of the application. And then you have specialized tests to test specific features. So actually, when you're building features from which you know as a developer, this is one area. For example, we actually build PDF files in our software. We do XML transformations or whatever memory intensive operations. We can already pinpoint potential pain areas in our application, and we can actually write specific tests to test these specific features. And now that we had this whole plan, and we have to actually make this acceptable to all our performance teams, because, well, I just said that we've all matured as developers into seeing that unit testing and integration testing has added value for our code and our product. And now we have to actually see that performance testing and putting effort into doing performance testing as developers is also helping us improve the quality of our code, and is something that we need to do. And in our opinion, to get developers to accept these types of things, to accept unit testing, integration testing, performance testing in this case, tool support is key. And that's where my colleague Bert-Jan comes in.
Thank you, Tim.
So, quick recap. Tim told us all kind of things about process and the place that performance testing should take in this process. Who of you fully agrees with everything Tim said? All right, who partly agrees? Okay, so what are the points are you that you are comfortable with?
Cool or not cool?
What parts don't you agree with? Which do you have a different opinion?
I have some reservations to regard performance testing as completely separate from unit or integration tests.
Yeah, all right.
To me, it seems that everything you test has a repercussion in performance. In the performance dimension, and it has a execution time, and that execution time can change for a unit test as well for an integration test. So all of them are in fact have ever performance.
Yeah. So your point is that you should performance test on basically on each level of your delivery cycle, unit testing, integration testing, performance testing. So anyone else who would like to comment on parts you don't agree with? All right, so let's continue. First, one more question to get to know each other a bit better. Who of you is a software developer? Who of you is a software tester? All right, anyone didn't raise his hand? Software managers or architects? Yes, all right. So. As Tim said on the previous slide, we think that having the right tool for the job is a key point. Basically applies to everything you do as a developer. But for performance testing, I think what really helped us was working with a tool we like. And Gatling is such a tool. And Gatling is an open source load testing framework based on Scala, Akka and Netty. It's different compared to more traditional tools for load testing like JMeter and Neoload, in that these tools have a thread per user approach. So when you're using JMeter or Neoload, for each simulated user or virtual user, it spins up a separate thread, and when there's a wait time for the user, it pauses that thread. So these tools are typically use relatively a lot of resources for simulating a lot of users, while Gatling using Akka, Scala, and Netty, it employs an actor model with an event loop that can share threads for multiple users, so it's a bit more resource friendly. Also, the interface with JMeter and Neoload, typically you have a GUI you use, or you configure them using XML, while Gatling has a DSL, a domain specific language you use to describe tests and to code tests. So the DSL is based on Scala. So when you're writing a Gatling scenario, you're basically typing Scala code, but you don't really need to know Scala to write a Gatling scenario. The DSL is pretty easy. I'll be demoing this shortly. It's pretty usable, but you can write Scala code in your tests. So when you're writing test scenarios, you have the full availability of all Scala tools and libraries you'd like to use, if you want to. But you can also stick to just the plain Gatling DSL for writing tests. So when you write a Gatling test, you typically write a scenario, which is a sequence of HTTP requests that simulate the usage of your application. So Gatling operates on HTTP level. Typically, when you write a web application, you have a browser that talks to your backend. Gatling is writing between, so it replays HTTP requests. It doesn't simulate anything in the browser, it doesn't measure performance in the browser, it just fires requests at your backend. When you want to inject data into your tests, you can use feeders. A feeder is a tool that Gatling provides to provide an input source for your test. For example, you can use a CSV file or JSON file or database to, for example, feed username and password combinations into your tests. And then there's a nice tool called the Gatling Recorder, which you can use to automate creating your Gatling scenarios. So this recorder can either work with a GUI and work as a proxy, or it can use a hard file, HTTP archive, which I'll be demoing soon. So let's start with the first demo. I'll be writing a basic Gatling script from scratch, where I'll be doing some simple performance testing at the Google search to see how well Google search is performing. Start by creating a simple test in Gatling. This is called a simulation. So simulation is a synonym for a test. It's just a plain base Scala class. I'll call it my first simulation. Then blow it up a bit. So it will extend from the Gatling simulation. So Gatling knows it's a simulation. I happen to know that by using the HTTP from Gatling too. So I start by inspecting Gatling by which protocol I will be accessing my application. In this case, it's Google, which is available over HTTP. So I'll define the HTTP protocol. The base URL I'll be accessing will be Google.nl. And I'll set a user agent header. So now I can define a scenario, which in this case is a flow of HTTP requests. And I'll name this Google search. Then I'll start by executing the first step, which is an HTTP call. And now I can describe which call I'm going to do. So I'm going to open the Google Start page, which is just a get to the root URL relative to the base URL. And when it's done, I'll check that the response status from this call is HTTP 2. Okay. So you can see that while you're typing this, it's fairly readable. Of course, you need to know the DSL to know what to type. But I find it fairly readable or fairly good to remember it and type it yourself. While in our use case, we're not typing any of the Scala code, we're just generating it, which I'll be showing later. So this is my scenario. Now I need to set it up. And I'll say my scenario injects some users. I'll make a user ramp up. So typically, when you're load testing, you don't fire up your full amount of users straight away from the beginning. But you have a ramp up to gradually increase the number of users you'll be sending. I'll start with the staggering amount of one user, just to show the working of the script. And I need to tell it that this will use the HTTP protocol. So one more import to fix. This is Scala confirm duration. So are we good? No, we're not yet. Help me out. Any typos I made? I don't think so. Check current users for 5 seconds. For voice input. I think my DE is compiling for some reason. Let me just fire it up. So now I'll be telling it to execute to this script. I'm using a Maven plugin, so it will start compiling now. So there's one error. So the protocol is not memorable for relation builder. And then I think I did something wrong. Yes, and I made a very minor typo. Remember some four protocols, four protocols. So now it's magically start working, which it is. So we use the Gatling Maven plugin, so I can easily run the Gatling scripts from my Maven build, which we use. So what it does, it fires up a Scala compiler. It will compile the Gatling Scala code for you, and then we'll execute the script. So if I execute this, it's readable, yes. Will now perform with one user a simple get to the Google start page, which has succeeded. Nothing really special yet. So let's spice it up a bit and perform an actual search. So now I can add a pause. So you can also simulate peak times. This can be important when you're trying to make representative test scripts. For example, when a typical user accesses the Google website or the Volcom website, typically he won't be frantically be firing HTTP requests to the website. He'll be clicking somewhere, thinking, waiting a while, and then doing another request. So it's pretty interesting when you're creating scripts and thinking of the loads you want to put in your system. For example, when 10 users are performing a request every second, you end up with the same number of requests per second as you have 100 users which request every 10 seconds. So by entering these pulses, you can, it helps you to create representative test scenarios. When you record test scenarios and translate them to Gatling and Gatling DSL, it will also incorporate these pulses. So I'll do a short break. I just need to think 1 second before I'm going to execute my Google search and then add an article. This is the perform Google search. I'll search on Gatling. And I happen to know that this is a get to slash search Q is Gatling. Because I know Google so well, I will always just put the URL and never search. Not really good to go. I want to check that the response code is alright. You actually don't need to do this because Gatling will automatically check all the responses for a valid response code like HTTP 200 or redirect. But for the example, it's alright. It will work now, but still, I would like to verify something on the request. So let's see if I manually perform this request. So I go to Google and then search, view Gatling. I get a result. I would like to check that, for example, the title of this page is conform what I'm expecting. So let me copy the title. So you can perform a number of checks. I'm now going to perform a regex check. Regex, let the title confirm to get the Google Zoom. So let me fire up it again. So still with one user, so not really interesting. But now it has opened the start page, performed the search, it's checked the status code, and it's checked that the response is Google Zoom Gatling. So now it's increasing the number of users a bit. Let's see if you can fire up 500 users over 10 seconds. So now I'll be performing 500 Google searches. It takes a while to start up because this will compile the Scala file, which takes a while. Now you'll see progress here. So you can see how many users are waiting, how many users are active, how many users are done. Because it's a very short script, they're done pretty fast. And you can see the results here. So I've done 1,000 requests, minimum response time, max, mean response time, standard deviation, percentiles, and I did about 87 records per requests per second. And all of them returned within 800 milliseconds. So let's try it again, because I know something is about to happen, which demonstrates what happens when things go wrong. So this is still alright. Let's try one more right after this. You are? Could be. When I was trying this, this is a good point actually. Well, let me try one more. When I was trying this at home, something funny happened. Google stopped responding. And of course, I probably can't break Google with just my laptop. But still, it's fun to see that these things happen when you put load on a system like this. When I tried this at home, it happened when I performed around 1,000 Google searches within a second. Yeah, there it goes, in a time frame. So now it says, I'm expecting a status code to run it, but I've responded with a 503. So let's see what's going on. I'm going to search on Gatling. But now it says, wow, you can't search on Gatling. There's, we have to take the usual traffic from your network, etc. So now I need to form a unreadable captcha. And then I'm good again. Alright, so probably for the next hour or so, if we're using the same network as I am, it'll be kind of bothered by what I just demonstrated, but still, it shows you that with just a simple scenario, you can put quite a lot of load on the system. And I'll be showing reports later, because these are just very basic reports of a test result, which gives a simple overview of the amount of requests fired and how many went from the right, how many didn't go right. You see when you have a larger scenario, the HTML reports that are being generated will be interesting. So, you know, for the first demo, any questions so far? Yes?
The main course for this is, of course, they were included in the Jenkins run.
Yeah.
So how is the integration in terms of defining thresholds?
Yeah. Yeah, so the question is, how is the integration in terms of defining thresholds for jobs? we haven't played with that. We're just using the default threshold. So Gatling divides response times into three categories. We can see them in the report. Let's see. So it says these response times are below 800 milliseconds. These are between 800 and 1.2 seconds. These are above 1.2 seconds. I'm not sure if these are configurable. It would be very interesting to see what are the thresholds for your system, because I can imagine that 800 milliseconds will be on the slow side. You might want to know that every response is returned within 100 milliseconds. What we're using this for in our setup is mainly for benchmarking. So we don't use this to measure the actual load that our application can endure in production. We use this to put a significant load on test environment and then measure the average response times over time and see how this will vary. So when something changes in our application that has a significant impact on the average response times, we get notified. This is integrated in Jenkins, which I'll be showing in just a minute. But there's a good point in how configurable this all is. It is open source, it is Scala, so you can configure everything. But then there might be some Scala hacking needed to change the Gatling stuff.
Yeah, we actually do have some code around this that actually operationalizes our scripts, and we actually parameterize our Jenkins jobs with the amount of users and the ramp-up time, for example. So there are possibilities to do this, but we do this by actually modifying the Gatling DSL.
Yeah, so there was a basic demo, just typing Scala code from the top of my head, and then making a script all by hand. But this can be fairly complex when you have a complex flow between front and back end. So what we're typically doing is recording scripts in a browser, and then using this to convert it to a Gatling script. So the process is like this. We have a browser. You can just use Firefox or Chrome, which we use to log into our system and then click through a performance test path. So we have a specific entry point in our system. We're making educational applications, so where students can perform lessons, for example. So we have a specific entry point in our application, which is really using test environments, where you can log in by just going to a specific URL. Then we'll on the fly create a new user for you, create a profile for that user, and make sure that this user can perform tests. And then from then on, everything we do with the application is just bound to that user and that session. So we can perform one click path through our system, use a special login entrance, perform a lesson, and then answer questions, and then submit the lesson. And this path is reusable for thousands or for 10,000 users afterwards. So that's a fairly simple use case. We also have some more dynamic use cases for systems that allows teachers to perform tests on students. And in that case, the scripts are a bit more complex because the teacher needs to plan a test which gets assigned to a specific student, and then the student needs to perform this test, so that the flow is a bit more dynamic. But in most applications, the flow is fairly static. So we open up a browser, we go to the special load test entrance, which generates a user on the fly, then click through our lesson, and then just export the request flow that was going on between the front end and the back end. So when you go to Firebug or to the Firefox developer tools, Chrome developer tools, you can record network activity. And actually in both browsers, there's an option which says export my network log as a ARC, or an HTTP archive, which is basically a JSON file which represents all the requests and responses that was done by the browser while you were recording network traffic. And we find this a fairly easy way to work. The alternative is to use the Gatling recorder and to use it as a proxy. Then you would need to have to run the Gatling recorder on the same machine as the machine where you record the test, and then to configure your browser to connect to the proxy. And with this way, our testers click through the test path in the browser, then just export a HAR file and throw it over to the developers, and then one of the developers converts it to a Gatling simulation. So we feed this HAR file to the Gatling recorder, which ultimately converts it to the Gatling DSL. But there are usually some custom changes you need to do. For example, in our case, our front end has some logic for processing cross-site requests for three tokens. So when you log in, the back end sends an HTTP header back with a cross-site request for three token, and then the front end needs to take that token and put it as a header back for each subsequent request. So you're missing this logic when you're recording between the front end and the back end. So we need to perform some custom changes. For example, record this cross-site request for three token, put it on each subsequent request. You might do some other stuff, maybe regarding cookies or such, but we found that Gatling does most of this stuff automatically. So cookie handling is also already done. You don't need to do anything specific for this. Just specific logic that would be in your front end that the script would need to replay. So then these custom changes are performed, a change DSL rolls out, which you feed into Gatling, which produces support. So one of the key points for us was to automate as much as possible from this process. So actually, right now only the first step is manual. So a tester opens up his or her browser, clicks through the test path, exports the R, and all the rest is automated. So we have built a wrapper around the Gatling recorder to automatically help us convert the R file to the DSL. Then there's a pragmatically written Java program that processes the generated DSL and does some find replace in there to make the changes automatic. And then it gets fed into Gatling, gets recorded, and you're done. So we want to do this because it's important to often re-record your test scenarios because things might change in the front end that impact the number of requests that are being sent to the back end. For example, we've had a performance issue where after a release, the performance of one of our systems halved or doubled in the response times. And it turned out that there had been a change in the front end where some expensive call on the back end was being called twice as much. So that's why we need to re-record these scenarios often. Otherwise, we won't see the effects of change in front end reflected in our performance test. So time for another demo. We built a small demo application, which is a trivial web application. Wow, we're gone. Let's see. Might be me. Most certainly won't be you. Let's see again. If all else fails, just try again and you'll succeed. So there's a web app. It's a small Vertex application. And if you use Vertex before, Vertex is a small reactive toolkit for the JVM. This does is it fires up a basic web server which handles HTTP requests. It sends out a simple HTML page. If no parameters are present in the request, if parameters are present, it will generate a stream of numbers ranging from 0 to the number you've entered at the web page. And then it will send this range of numbers to a separate service, called a microservice, that has the task of sorting these numbers. When this service replies, it will take those numbers and respond them back to the web page. So let's take a look at how this works. So we have our app running. And it's a very simple box, but I type in 10 here. It will generate a string of numbers from 0 to 9. Send it to the sorter service. The sorter service will perform a reverse sort return the result, and return it back to the application. So why this application? Because the sorter service is a service where we can switch the implementation of our sorting algorithm. So if we sort this list of numbers with a significantly large list of numbers, we'll see difference in performance of the sorting algorithm in this case. Well, that's what I hope for that. So we'll see. I'll start with the first sort, which is a bubble sort, and I'll show you how to record a basic Gatling scenario for this use case. So I'll enable my Chrome developer tools. I'll tell it to preserve all my network activity. For my get to the page, and say, well, let's send you a list of 15,000 numbers. So when I sort it and then return all the numbers, and then I'm done. So here is the request flow. I can now save this as a R file. And this is just a JSON file which represents the request flow. So I'll copy this R file into my project. There's already one there, but I'll just copy it over. And just to show you the anatomy of the R, this is a JSON file with all the requests I did. So here's a GET request to go a bit. A GET request to localhost 8080. And then somewhere below here, there will be a second request. Here's a get to localhost slash count is 15,000, and then the response will be in here too. So just recording the request. So now I have the R file here. We've set up a wrapper around the Gatling recorder, which will take this R file and then convert it into a Gatling DSL. I'm using the Maven Scala run plugin to start our wrapper, which will convert it. So now it says in observation the same name exists, so it probably didn't do anything useful, or they informed me of my mistake. Let me throw this one away. Let's convert the observation to. So again. No simulation with the same name exists. So how about that? Not sure why it's the same code, because it's generating a new one. So here's our generated Scala Gatling simulation, which looks fairly similar to the Google simulation I just showed you. There's some different things in there. It has configuration for Gatling, which is copied from the wrapper script we use. So it says to not download any JavaScript files, CSS files, GIFs, because we're just interested in requests from the to the backend that will actually perform work on the backend. There's some caching headers set. Then here the URI set, and we'll first perform a get, and then perform a get with the count 15,000. So let's now perform a test using this script with a number of users. Let's see, rank users 500 over, let's say, 10 seconds. Fire up my web app. Running. So now Gatling will replay request flow. I just showed it with the R file. And it will start hitting the web app with 500 users performing the request. So I'll be seeing requests flying by here probably. And you can see it showing the sort results. You can see the progress here. So it's adding 50 users every second. This will take a while. So what did you do at the AmsterdamJUG meetup? We sat and watched the progress bar. There it is. I won't be showing you the reports just yet. But I will be. So we can see here it fired a 1,000 requests. The mean response time was 4.4 seconds. let's now switch to another sorting algorithm.
Can you show it again?
Yeah.
Minimum response time is zero.
Yeah. That's interesting, right?
Yes.
It is in milliseconds, so it might be, well, it might be possible that one of the requests returned in 0 milliseconds. I'm not really sure, so. Oh yeah, that's interesting, right, yeah. So I think something, if there are no requests.
I think it might make sense if there's one of the five requests were chose page.
Oh yeah, right. Yeah. Just as the
because
the
if you see 50% of the requests is less than 800 milliseconds.
Yeah,
this is the empty page. So,
this is just the get to the page. But still, it says 0 seconds were executed here. 0 requests were executed here. None of them were false. So I'm not sure what this is. This might be an issue in the Gatling because I'm really not seeing this. But let's see how this turns out with the other implementations. So now I'm going to switch the implementation of the sorter service and going to use selection sort, which should be slightly different results. Set up tests. Let me look it up. So you can, what you're using for is, for example, this. So you can say I want to have a constant user during 15 seconds or loop during a period. So that's a really extensive way of setting your scenarios. They can loop or repeat. Also the setup of how many users you want. You can run scenarios in parallel and divide the user the first one and the second one. So there's a lot of stuff to play with there. So let's see if the second report still says minimum response time zero. So this is still there, not sure why this is. It says the minimum response time is now 1.4 seconds. So it was overall request, it was a bit faster. Let's now move to insertion sort, which should have some slightly different results. Execute the test again. So all I'm doing now is executing the same test 3 times while there's a different implementation on the backend, and we're going to see the results shortly. You can see that the mean response time is now 86 milliseconds, so it was a bit faster than the one before. So let's now take a look at the reports. So these are generated from by Gatling, so they're ready to use XML reports with some graphing in there and some fancy moving bars when you open them. What you see here is basically a repeating information for the simulation summary already showed you. So there were 500 requests with a response time below 80 milliseconds, and a few between 800 and 1.2 seconds, and then a lot larger than 1200 milliseconds. So here you can see per request, you can see the results. Typically, in a scenario, you have like 10 or 50 requests, and then you can zoom in to the specific one request. You can also sort. For example, you can say, give me the request with the highest mean response time or the maximum response time. So this usually really helps on finding which of the requests from your test were the slowest. So then there's a few reports below, the active users. So while I told it to run with 500 users per rep of 10 seconds, actually some of the first ones were already done before the last ones were in. So we had a maximum of 410 users. You see response time distributions here, and then these graphs are usually the most interesting. You can see the response time percentiles over time. So you can see whether response times will be flat and stable during your test, or will go up or go down. And something we typically see is that, for example, when a system gets overloaded over time, then response times will start spiking. For example, we're running my current project, we're running these tests daily. What we're seeing there is that a test would be stable, like all response times below 1 second for like 2 weeks. And then suddenly the average response times were going up. So if we were aware that there must be something wrong. We started looking at these graphs, and we can see that the graphs were still pretty stable, but in the end they would suddenly start spiking. And when we looked at the report here, when we zoomed in on which of these requests are slow, it turned out that the request at the end of our test scenario, which in our case was the student has performed an assessment and submits the assessment, that request was spiking. So we knew that we must have changed something there that had a fairly negative impact on the performance. So if you compare these three reports, this is the first one. Second one, we can see that there are already more requests in the green zone. And the third one, they're all in the green. So we can look at this graph and see how response times compare. In the first one, we see that they're just going up all the time. And the second one, we kind of see the same, but once we can hear the number two is already decreasing. And the third one, we see is a small buildup in the beginning, and then over time, they're just staying in the same state. So these graphs are using fairly useful to see how the response times during the test behave. And typically you're looking for graphs here that have spikes somewhere to see that something happened or that they are going up. Then the system probably can't handle the load if you do more use on it. And in the good scenario, it will be stable and flat over the duration of the test. So, to continue, about reporting, we've seen the two graphs on the left. So what we typically do is name our requests in such a way that we can recognize them. So in my demo, it only showed request 0, request 1. Here we have the select page we use to log in. Here is a get to get the course. Here's a post on state, so we can easily recognize which REST API we're calling, which are the response times according to that goal. Here's a graph over time. So we can see that here, when the number of users is going up, response time are going up a bit, but when they are stable, time response time stays stable, and when the users decrease, response times already also decrease. So there might be an issue here, but since this is fairly linear to the number of users, it won't spike really fast when we double the number of users. So it's also interesting to see at the relation between the number of users and the average response times. So there was a question before running this on a continuous integration environment. We're running this on Jenkins, so we're using the Gatling Jenkins plugin, and that's where this graph is produced from. So what you see here is every number here is a Jenkins build. So we use Jenkins to perform our Gatling tests. So typically, we perform these tests twice a day, so each morning and each evening, and it just sets a significant load on one of our test environments. So we've experimentally found that, for example, when a small test environment has a load of 200 concurrent users, it will be on some sort of strain, so because the average response times will be around 1 second. So we aim at putting just the amount of strain on the environment so that differences in the performance of the application will amplify the results. So what we're seeing here is that we put an amount of strain on the environment where the average response time of the entire test suite was around a second. It got up here a bit, probably because the amount of data in the environment increased, which made the application perform slightly less. And then suddenly there's a huge drop, and the average response time go from 1.2 seconds to 500 milliseconds. So any thoughts on what would have happened here?
New hardware.
new hardware. Actually, that's about right. Yeah. We were surprised by this problem because there was we were just doing this for a week or so, and the results have been fairly stable. And then this was a test at night, and this was a test in the morning. And we were like, well, so who made the system twice as fast during the night? Well, of course, nobody did. Actually, somebody did, because it turns out that, that one of our ops guys had, by accident, changed the instance type of the machine that the test environment was running on. So we were on Amazon in the cloud, and we can very easily change the instance types of machines. And in this case, the type was changed from a, I think it's a medium instance to a large instance, for example. So it's twice the amount of computing power and memory. And we didn't see this during the day because we throw away all our servers at night, so they don't cost us any money at night, and then we rebuild them all in the morning. So when the machine was rebuilt in the morning, it ran on a new instance type, and then suddenly it was like twice as fast. We were like, oh, what happened? Then we start looking at the at our Amazon console and see, wow, this is a larger instance. And we asked the guy, so why the larger instance? Oh, yes, I think I mistyped your private name. I want to upgrade another another one. So typically, we don't see these large drops. But we can use this to have actually both things, two things. A feedback during our sprints when we're developing stuff on how the average response time of our applications are is developing. So typically we want the line to be stable. And secondly, we can have really fast turnaround times on experimenting with performance fixes. So in the traditional scenario, when we would be doing performance tests, we'll be somewhere in an environment close to production, our staging environment or pre-production environment. And an external party would test it, and then we get results, and then draw conclusions and did a fix in application. We had to deliver it to the hosting party. They would deploy it there, and then the external party would perform the test, and we'll have feedback on our performance fix somewhat in the course of a day or so, 2 or 3 days, which was fairly long when you're impatient type like me. So what we're doing now is we're managing all environments ourselves, which is a big difference. We're doing it running this on a test environment, which is the first environment our software gets deployed to. We can deploy a new version to the environment with a push of a button. We can actually, we don't even need to push a button, it applies it like me. And we can start a performance test with a push of a button. So the turnaround time for trying out a fix now is somewhat in the order of like 30 minutes or 50 minutes when running it on a test environment. We can also easily run this test locally, just like maybe get an action and run it on your local environment. So turnaround time of getting feedback on performance fixes has drastically decreased, which is a good thing when you want to make progress on creating performance fixes. So we typically only see these kinds of drops when there are absolutely no indexes on the database and we add indexes, or something is horribly wrong and we fix it. So what does this bring us? Since we're only just doing benchmarking, so we can see how changes in our code and in our infrastructure affect the performance of our application. We can have short feedback cycle on the performance of our application. This does not enable us to see the maximum load we can endure in production. Is this a problem? It depends. We're already running in production with most of our projects. Their performance is pretty stable. The amount of users is also pretty stable. So what we're doing now is measuring the performance on a test environment and kind of having a trust that if the performance on a test environment doesn't really degrade that much, the performance in production won't also degrade that much. And so far this has worked for us. Of course, there will be an example somewhere in the future where this doesn't work. Yes?
Is this a problem with scale or with realistic data? Why wouldn't it be with
I think the question is why is it representative for the load the application of during production? I think both your suggestions are right. There's a problem with scale, since our test environments are running in a, well, let's say, identical setup of production, but with smaller machines. So we're running fairly small hardware for test environments. And also with representative data. Our test environment is populated with new data every day, so it's typically fairly small, while production has a lot of existing data. So the only way to know which load your application can endure in production is to test this in production or on a very, very, very representative production environment. So, but we found that when we monitor, when we know that performance is alright in production, we monitor our test environments, we're fairly good with the results in production so far. So what has this brought us? It has prevented some issues in production, because we noticed it on our test environment and looked into it and we're able to fix it. It helped us a lot in testing performance fixes and tuning our database indexes and stuff like that. It helped discover an error in test infrastructure, which we've seen just moments ago. It helped us track down and validate the fix for a memory leak, I believe. Was this in the MongoDB Java driver? We're using MongoDB, and the MongoDB team provides a Java driver, and we suspected that there was a memory leak in there. So these tests helped us to track down the leak, try out the fix, and then submit this fix to the MongoDB Java driver team. And it helped us a lot to tweak database indexes. We just run a test, put the system on the load, and then ask Mongo, how are you doing? What's the load on the different collections? Are indexes being hit and stuff like that? So the ability to, by yourself as a developer, put an environment on the load, see the results, create fixes, and then do it again, we found this really powerful. What we like to do next, the recording process isn't really automated yet. The first part, clicking through the scenario, is still a manual process. We have some ideas on how to do this, but we haven't really found a solution yet, so for now we're doing this by hand labor. We also have a lot of functional tests using Fitness and Protractor, which already test our application on functional level, so I think it would be nice if we could reuse these scenarios to use performance testing, since now we're just clicking through these scenarios by hand, duplicating which we've already automated. And these custom code changes that we're doing in performing search replaces, regexes on the generated DSL, isn't too pretty either, so we'd like to get rid of those too. We might need to talk to the Gatling team to find some issues for this. So time is up. Content is also almost up. Some takeaways we'd like to share with you. We think that performance testing should be a first-class citizen in your development cycle. Because your application can work functionally beautiful, look great, be usable, and respond like shit, then nobody will use it. Performance is as important as functionality. Always keep in mind that changes in your front end can impact backend performance. If a call is executed twice or three times as much as it was before, probably you can handle about half or one third of the use before. We love Gatling. We think it's awesome. It's programmer friendly. And it's really useful for load testing. And what we shared is a way of benchmarking your application's performance, monitoring trends in performance. It does not determine by default the maximum load your production environment can measure. So one more disclaimer to take home. Knowing how to use a tool is one thing. Creating good tests that make sense with the tool is another thing. So we show you the basics of Gatling as a tool. You need to compare it with the thorough knowledge of how to set up some test scenarios and interpret those scenarios to be able to really make sense of the test algorithm. So everything we showed is on GitHub. The application, demo application, is on Tim's repository. On my GitHub repository, there's a simple seed project where the Gatling main plugin is configured, where the wrapper for the recorder is in, so you can just check it out and get started by way. So I believe that's about it. Any questions? Yes?
So you're using Gatling more or less after you've pushed your code.
Yeah.
I was wondering, have you tried it out before the code being pushed?
Yeah, so the question is,
on your local computer.
Yeah. So the question is, you're using Gatling after you've pushed the code.
Yeah.
After trying out locally. The reason why we use it after we push it, because we want to not make this a standard step in when developers work on their code. When someone pushes it, it will automatically gets built, put a representative test environment, and then the performance tests run, where you can get this feedback in Jenkins. We have tried it on local machines, yes. It works fairly well on local machines, but typically only do this when we are working on performance fixes. So when we're just building new features, we have the automated performance test running on our build server on our test environment as a backup. When we're actually investigating issues and working on fixes, we can run it locally. Yes.
Mm. The reason we're not doing it continuously locally is also a time issue, because both these performance test scenarios can take a fairly long time to run. Yeah. So each iteration, each build iteration locally, will increase drastically when you include the performance test at the end as well. So that's why we choose to actually do it after we push our code, and only when we are actually focusing on performance.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Do you make sure that only your performance test is running on the environment?
Yeah. How do you make sure that only our own performance test is running on the environment? We're not really doing that. No, we're running our build environment is we use Jenkins. We use Jenkins with auto scaling slaves. So every time a job needs to run on Amazon, we will spin up a slave and a job runs there. These slaves have two executors. So in theory, or actually in practice, it could happen that Gatling test for project A and Gatling test for project B is running concurrently on the same machine, which will impact, which might impact the results of the test. But since we're only applying a relatively low load on machines, like to run the concurrent users, I don't think that really we will really see that much influence of the test run concurrently. And also, since we scheduled the tests to run early in the morning and late at night, these environments are usually not only used by them, but just we see some fluctuation in results, and this fluctuation can be impacted by loads of things amongst the other load on the specific Jenkins node that the test is running on.
So those tests are not, the chance that there are two Jenkins jobs running two different tests to the same test environment is fairly small.
No, that's close to zero, since every project has its own test environment. And we make these tests lock on some other jobs. For example, when a test is running, deployments to the environment are blocked. Any more questions?
Another question.
Yeah.
You say these tests do not say anything about capacity. You could think of a ramp-up scenario going up to a level that's higher than you expect.
Yeah, of course, but
have some figures for capacity at least in that environment. And if that is changing, then something is also not right.
Yeah, you're true. So the suggestion is we could also create a break test and see at what number of concurrent users the current environment will break. I think it's an interesting suggestion. We're not doing this since our previous thought was this is only useful to measure the actual number of users an environment can endure when this is a production-like environment, because otherwise it will just be numbers. But still, seeing which amount of concurrent users an environment will break is interesting information. So.
Yeah, there's nothing preventing you from running these same scenarios on an environment that is similar to production. But there's nothing preventing you from doing that. We're not doing it in our approach. But it could be not.
Yeah, and it's very good that it's about comparison, because you compare it to a previous.
One more question. I was wondering if you tested Gatling in a scenario where you have all the peripheral system stubbed, all the systems stubbed, versus live.
Yeah, so that's a good question. The question is, are we testing on an environment which has stubs for the external interfaces or is connected to live systems? We have the advantage that we don't have too many interfaces with external systems, actually only a few. So our analytics cluster, where we send data analytics to, and the system we use for single sign-on. So both these systems are stubbed on our test environment. Mm. So if you only want to measure performance of our application.
For our own code changes.
Yeah, for our own code changes.
Yeah.
But the performance of these stubs can impact the performance of our application too. So we've seen examples where our not so good performance setup of the analytics service would slow down the performance of our test. So that is something you need to take into account.
Yeah.
Okay, so thanks for